Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. This is Dilmer again, and today I'm really excited because I'm going to continue the videos with ML agents in Unity. In this video, I'm going to show you what you see playing behind the scenes, which is a demo that I created to basically learn how ML agents work. This demo also provides you with all the source code available in GitHub. You guys can download it. You can see how I implemented the agents, also how I implemented the target moving, and also the area that you see in the video. So let's jump into Unity and start working on it. All right, guys, so let me show you what I have here. So I'm gonna go ahead and hit play and show you the train data that I did create with the, you know, running the simulation multiple times. So you can see that the agents are moving from one side to another, and there's actually three points. There is a point right on the middle, and then there's a point right here, and then also a point on the left. So what they're trying to do is avoid a block from hitting, you know, from hitting the agent. I also added a couple of things. Let me just go ahead and turn off the gizmos. And I added three different stats. One, it's going to be a reward that they are basically accumulating as they are, you know, avoiding the block. There's also how many episodes we're completing. Like in this case, this has completed 23 episodes, this one 24, and then also the step count. So I keep aggregating this value as the, you know, as the agent is avoiding the block. So the other thing that I want to show you is that these agents also adapt to the speed of the block. So if I were to change the speed, you're gonna see how amazing this is. If I go into target, which is every single one of those, and if I select them all and I go in and say, okay, you know what? I want to increase their speed maybe by 5, so I can say 15. You can see that the agents, if I go into the game view, agents are still doing okay. I don't see, you know, I don't see any red. Green means that they are getting avoided, and red means that they're actually colliding. So there's no red, so that's a good sign. So if I go to 20, there are some reds, but we're still getting, you know, a lot of green. So let's go ahead and crank it up to something like 50. So you can see that the agents are, I mean, they're not doing that bad. Some of them are doing okay. The reason why some of them are doing bad is because I didn't train with the speed, right? So I train it with a lower speed, but they're still doing okay. Like I'm getting a lot of green, and then some red. So what about doing something like 100? You can still see that the agents are still doing okay. So if I go ahead and go back here, and you can see that the agents, I mean, this one is going super, super fast. This one as well, and it's actually avoiding quite a bit of them. There is no negative numbers on the cumulative reward. So if that number goes down, that means that, you know, we're actually getting more red than we're getting green. So this is looking really good, and I'm going, you know, super, super fast. So if I were to go a lot faster, which I haven't tried, and this is gonna be the first time that I do that in these videos, it's gonna be 150. Let's see how that works. And it's really hard to tell, but they're actually, you know, they're actually avoiding the block. So these agents are really, really smart. The cool thing about this is just think about, you know, creating a game where you have to code the AI by, you know, by hand. And it just takes a lot of work. There's a lot of things to consider where these are just learning, and, you know, as I run them through training, they're getting much better. So the training data is already being created. So what I'm gonna show you is everything that it took me to create this project. And I'm going to try to, you know, be as detailed as I can. I was gonna do it from the, you know, from the very beginning and create it with you, but it ended up being a lot more work. So I'm going to show you the results. So if we go to this player avoidance area, this is gonna be basically what makes up the agent and also the area. So I'm gonna show you a couple of things that are included in here. So of course the floor, it's in here, it's just a plane with, you know, a material on it. I also have what's called the wall. So if we look at the wall here and we were to look at the collider, I ended up adding a collider that basically extend. The reason why I did that is because sometimes the queue was going so fast that the collision wasn't getting detected. So I decided just to extend it, you know, a little bit further. And then, you know, things started to work just fine. So this wall is the one that the, what I call the target, it's going to be hitting. As soon as it hits it, I'm going to give it a point. If for whatever reason, we can't really, you know, hit the wall, we hit the player. In that case, this is called the, I call it the avoidance. If we go into the player and you look at the agent, I call it the agent avoidance. So if the target hits the agent, in that case, I'm going to be basically penalizing the agent because the agent wasn't smart enough to avoid it. The other thing that I also do is I move this to the right and also to the left and also to the middle. So when we talk about, you know, creating, you know, discrete actions, sometimes you're gonna hit continuous and also discrete. In this case, this is all doing discrete actions because I am moving the agent to the right. I'm also keeping it in the middle and also moving to the left. So there's gonna be three different actions that this agent is gonna have. So the goal here, it's actually pretty straightforward, is I have a target. The target is gonna move towards that at a specific speed. And then the agent, what it's gonna do is going to start receiving information from TensorFlow, from the ML agents, you know, framework, and it's gonna say, you know what, I'm gonna try to move to the right to see what happens. If I move to the right and I get a point because I don't collide with this guy, I'm going to track that information. And if I'm here and that guy basically collides with me, that's not good. So I'm going to basically penalize the agent. And the same thing, if I move the agent to that side, then that means that, you know, I did well, because at that point, the target, if the target was hitting the wall, in that case, we're basically doing okay, right? Because we want the target to hit the wall, because that means that I avoided a target. So let's go ahead and go back and look a couple more things. So the agent has a lot of different things that I'm gonna be showing you here. And then also the target has a rigid body, collider, and then also a target moving script, which I'm gonna be walking you through as well. And then the dashboard. So dashboard has just three different metrics. I'm tracking that information, and then that information is displaying here. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna show you the most basic thing, which is going to be the target. So like I was saying, the target, it has a mesh render, which is just a simple cube. It has a box collider, it has a rigid body, it basically has, you know, gravity, and then these are just basically default values. And then it also has a script that I call it target moving. So the target moving script is responsible for moving the actual target at a specific rate. And I decided to set the speed by default to be 10. I also decided to set the max distance to be 15. So if the distance between, you know, the starting point up to here, it's basically greater than, and I'm gonna show you what that is. If I'm passing the agent and I'm hitting the wall, in that case, I know that, you know, I actually got a point. And I'm actually getting the point calculation by just looking at collisions. So I'm gonna show you that code as well. So let's go ahead and take a look at the agent. The agent is gonna be the one that has most of the, you know, the scripts. So it has a sphere collider because we're gonna be colliding with it. It also has a rigid body, and most of these values are just default. I ended up setting the freeze position to be Y and Z because I didn't want the agent to be, you know, moving up or moving, if in case that this guy collides with it, I don't want it to be moving up or actually moving on the Z direction. So we're gonna leave the actual agent at that point. He's just gonna be moving from on the X axis. The other thing that I have in here is a trail render, and that's what you can see. The reason why I did that is because I wanted to see a line just to make sure that it was gonna be moving in the, you know, the points that I designated. The other things that I have here is I have the behavior parameters. This is something that I covered in the previous video, but I designated a behavior name. So this is gonna be called the player avoidance. So if I have, let's say, you know, I show you in the demo, I have about 20 different areas in here. Each of the areas are called player avoidance area, and each of them have basically the same player, and the player has a behavior name. So what's happening is this is basically what's gonna be sent to the academy. Academy is gonna say, oh, I have a player avoidance behavior. So that guy is doing okay. Well, this one is also doing okay. This one is not doing that well, but I'm gonna be training all of them at the same time. So all the information, all the training is gonna go through the same behavior. It's basically gonna be a key. And that key is going to help us, you know, get more information because we have 20 agents getting exercise at the same time versus just one agent getting exercise at one time, right? So let's go ahead and go back into here. And let's go back into the player. So behavior name is really important. Just give it a key. And, you know, if you wanna have different behaviors, then those ones have to be unique. In this case, I'm just gonna use that one. The space size is gonna designate what I'm gonna be observing. So in this case, I want to, there's a couple of things that I wanna be observing. One of them is going to be, in this case, gonna be the target. I wanna know where that target is at all times. And I'm also going to be observing the position of the agent. So if we go and look at the Visual Studio solution and I look at the aging avoidance, and we look at this, basically this right here, I'm going to have basically six observations. So when I started working on this, I was a little confused because I'm like, oh, why is it six if I only have two lines? Well, the reason that it's six is because I'm tracking three different positions. I'm tracking X, Y, and Z for the agent, and I'm also tracking X, Y, and Z for the target. So let's go ahead and go back in here. So that's where the space size is set to six. The vector action in this case is discrete because I don't want to continue movement. I'm going to basically have three different positions that I'm gonna be tracking. One of them is gonna be a 0, 0, 0. The other one is going to be, you know, an offset to the right, and then the other one is going to be an offset to the left. So it's gonna put it back in the middle. So when I set the branches size of the actions, it's going to be set to a one, but I'm basically gonna have three. So, and that's why those are gonna be the three numbers that we're going to be tracking. So it's gonna be one here, one over here, and then one over here. So if we had, let's say, four different spots that we wanted to move the agent, I wanted to put it here, also here and here, and let's perhaps, I wanted to put it right here. In that case, this number will be four. So in my case, it's gonna be three. Let's go ahead and undo that. And then this is gonna be the model. The reason why I have a model right now is because I already trained this agent. When you start, you're not gonna have any models, but as soon as you start training the agent and you finish the training, you're gonna get that file created. Let's go ahead and undo. We're gonna be using the CPU for training. We're not gonna be using the GPU, so I have that set to the CPU. And then this is really important because if you're using what's called default means that we're going to be training against the Python, the ML agents, you know, components that are available. So if I go ahead and open PowerShell and we go into, let's go ahead and jump into code and then I have virtual environments. And then in here I have my Unity. In this case, I have the agent setup environment. And I also have a script folders. And this is something that I showed you on the previous video. And if I do that, and let me go ahead and go back, and then I'm going to go into this project, which is going to be called it's actually called the Unity ML Essentials. In there, I have a folder called assets. And then in the assets, I have my config folder. So the config has everything that I need to be able to train these. So I could do ML agents and then learn. And then I'm gonna go into my config folder. And then in this case, I did a player avoidance file. I'm gonna give it the run ID. And then the run ID in here is gonna be test. So whenever you execute these, it's going to run through the training. And I showed you that on the previous video. I'm not gonna show it to you right now, but you're going to basically hit play. It's going to start, you know, show you the Unity screen. This is gonna be the tools that the ML agents team provided to you. And then what you need to do is you need to hit play, and then that's going to start showing the training. I'm gonna do that at the very end so that you guys can see it before training and also after training. I'm just gonna go ahead and kill it. There we go, and let's just clear the screen. So in the case of default, it's going to basically be using these tools. And then in the case of heuristic, that means that we're going to be controlling the action. So you as a developer have basically the power to control what actions are going to be driving the behavior. So, and I'm gonna show you that as well. And then the script that is really important in here, it's going to be the agent avoidance. This one is going to, it's the one that I implemented. I inherit from agent, and then I have a reference to the mesh collider because I need to know, you know, what material to use when there's a success. I wanna know what material to use when there's a failure. You guys can see that I have a red one for, you know, when there's a failure. For the success, I have the green one. And then the default in this case is gonna be the gray. I also have a speed that I'm setting for the edging itself. I wanna tell it, you know, how fast to move to the right, how fast to move to the left, and then, you know, how fast to go back to the idle position. These are some values that I set up initially to basically determine what's an idle, what's the left position, and also what is the right position. But you guys can tell that this doesn't know where to move to, right? So that's the magic of machine learning. It knows where to go, but it doesn't know at what point it needs to move to the right, it needs to move to the left, or it needs to stay in the middle. Let's go ahead and go back. And then these are just a couple of labels that I'm changing in the script, the reward value, episodes value, and step value. The decision requester is going to be really important because it's going to tell the system, you know, how fast it needs to request a new decision. I set it to 5. That was the default. That actually works really well. I actually did 1 and it wasn't working quite well. So it was taking way too much, you know, the performance was really, really bad. So I ended up doing, you know, a number 5 on the decision period. That actually worked great. And then the trail render, that's basically the trail that you can see right there. So the other thing that I'm going to be focusing on, let's go ahead and look at the script. I know that I'm talking a lot, guys. There's just a lot to cover. So what I'm going to be covering here is basically what I do for the functionality of machine learning. So in this case, I am inheriting from base agent. I'm not inheriting from agent because I decided to do, you know, a little bit more inheritance because I wanted this script to do the whole couple of things that I'm going to be using throughout multiple tutorials. So I decided to create a base agent, and that base agent is going to be inheriting from agent. So the base agent has a ground mesh render, so it knows how to change the color of the mesh of the ground. So if it's a successful material, I have that reference here, failure material or default material, and also the method that, it's basically the method that Unity provided, and then that method takes a material, it takes a time, I change the ground material, I wait for this amount of seconds, and then I change the material back to the default material. So this is going to show you red as soon as I pass it in. It's going to wait for, you know, half a second, and then it's going to set it back to normal. So I thought this was going to be used throughout many tutorials that I create, so I put it in the, you know, in a different class. So let's go ahead and go back. So the aging avoidance and also my other scene, which is a player agent, they both inherit from that. So just so you know that I did some refactoring on that. And also know that I'm going to be putting this in GitHub, so don't worry about getting it all. It's going to be available in the description of this video. So a couple of things in here that I have is this is going to be the default speed of the agent. You saw that on the inspector, I have it set to 50. In this one, I set it to 10. It doesn't really matter if I set it to 10 here. I'm already overriding that on the inspector. I'll just do 50 for, you know, for clarity. And then I have the idle position, left position, and then right position. All of those are set to, you know, vector 0. And then a couple of labels that I'm using to display on the GUI. I also have a reference to the target because I need to basically reset the position of the target. So that's what that is. And I also have the overall reward and also the overall steps. I'm keeping track of those, and I'm going to show you that below. And then I also keep track of where I moved to and what was my previous position. The reason for that is because the agents are really sneaky. If I don't capture this information, what was happening is the agent was staying on the left and never going back or moving to the right. So what I'm doing in the agent code, I'm penalizing the agent. If the agent previous position and the current position are the same, then I am basically telling the agent, you know what? If you stay in that place for multiple times, I'm gonna penalize you more. So don't be sneaky. Go ahead and move to a new position. So you gotta be really smart about this, because if you don't know, the agents are really smart and they are really sneaky. So I also had another instance where the agent was so sneaky that it was moving so fast that the trigger, the actual physics in Unity, weren't getting detected. So he was just moving really, really fast, really fast. So the physics engine wasn't detecting a collision. So it was basically looking like I was winning. And in that case, it was actually tricking the game engine, which in my mind, it just blew my mind away. But anyway, so here I'm getting in the awake method, I'm getting the target moving reference. So I'm just going transform parent and then getting the target moving from the childs of the parent. Then when the on episode begin, I am basically setting the agent position to be the idle position. And then also the move to previous position, they are all set by default to the idle position. So I'm basically placing the agent in the middle when they start. And then I'm collecting the 6 different observations. In this case, there are 2 lines, but remember, these are 3 observations because each of them are X, Y, and Z. So I'm just calling sensor the add observation, getting the transform local position, and also the target moving transform local position. The next thing that I'm also doing is I'm overriding the onActionReceive. So the reason why I'm overriding that is because I need to know what the agent thinks that it needs to do, right? So the first thing that I do is I capture the previous position. So I grab the previous position and the move to. In this case, it's going to be the same. But when we go through these multiple times, this one is going to be a different number. So I'm going to be caching that information. Then I get the direction. I also convert the vector action at 0. And I convert that to an int by using the floor to int. So if this is 1.5, it's going to be, then the value of this is going to be, you know, 1. If this is 2.7, the value of this is going to be 2. And then, therefore, I'm going to basically use a switch statement to tell me what position to take, what direction to take. So in this case, if it's 0, we're going to stay at the idle position. If, you know, the ML agents tools give me a 1, in that case, I'm going to move to the left. If they give me a 2, I'm going to move to the right. And then if I, what I was doing before doing this move towards is I was doing this. I was just doing local position and then idle position. And this works, but the agents are sneaky. And when you do this, the agents are going to move so fast that the collisions are not going to happen. So it was looking like I was always winning. So make sure that you don't do that because you're going to have problems like me. So what I ended up doing is I changed the way that I was using this and implementing this, and I ended up doing vector 3, the move towards. I'm capturing the local position, and then I'm saying, okay, you know what, local position of the agent, go ahead and move towards this new position by use the time, fixed delta time, and then multiply it by the speed. Then the agents were moving a little bit slower, but the collision was actually happening, they were learning, and it was fair to the game to do that. Otherwise, it wasn't really working the way that I wanted to work. So the other thing that I also do is if the previous position and the move to position are the same, I'm going to punish the agent and I'm going to increment the counter. So I'm keeping track of how many times these two are the same. If they are the same, I'm going to increment the counter. If they're the same twice in a row, what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, you know what, agent, I'm going to punish you for moving to the same position multiple times. I also try with a 3. You can try this with multiple numbers. And you know, you can do different algorithms if you wanted to do that in a different way. But what I ended up doing is if the agent was moving to the same position twice, then I'm penalizing them, I'm resetting the counter, and then, you know, going through this process one more time. If you want to do 3, you can do 3 as well. That will work. I also will play with this number and see if you can get better results than I did. So that's how the agent would know, you know, what direction to take and where to go. The other thing that I also implemented is I take, you know, points away. I'm going to show you how this gets called. I also give, you know, points to the player. So on the take away points, that means that the target is actually colliding with the agent. So I'm going to be taking off points from the agent. So I'm penalizing it by, you know, subtracting that amount. And then at that point, I'm basically saying, you know what? I'm basically colliding with the agent, so I'm going to reset the position and also the local rotation of the target. I'm also going to be updating my stats because I know something happens. I need to basically capture the new overall reward, the new overall steps, and then basically show that on the canvas. And then what I do is I end the episode so that we can start over. And then I also swap the material, the ground material. In this case, this is negative, right? So we want to do a failure. And I'm showing the red material. In the case that we are colliding with the wall, which means that we're actually doing okay, the target got to the wall, we were able to avoid it, I'm basically gonna reward the agent and say, hey, you did a good job, so I'm going to increment it by 1. I'm going to add a reward of 1. I'm also going to be resetting the target because we're done. I'm going to update the statistics, ending the episode. And then in this case, I'm going to be showing a green color because this is a success case, right? The other thing that I also did is I overwrote the heuristic. And this is really cool when you guys are doing, you know, if you're starting machine learning, make sure that you start with this before you start anything else. So the thing that I recommend that you do is you start with this first so that you know how your agent is going to move. The cool thing with this is I have full control. So if I were to go back into Unity and I change, say that I change this agent to be, if I go here to behavior parameters, and I change it to heuristic only, what is going to happen is the ML agent framework is going to say, okay, you know what? I don't want to calculate these from, you know, from the ML agent's tools. What I'm going to do is I'm going to get the feedback from the input. So in this case, if I do a down arrow, I'm going to move to zero position. If I do a left arrow, I'm going to move to, you know, to that one position. And then if I do a right arrow, I'm going to move to the two position. What's cool about this is if you implement this and you actually hit these keys, it's actually going to call this and it's going to pass in those values. So you can have some agents that are going to be set as heuristic. Some agents are going to be set as default. And this is really helpful when you're debugging and you're developing because it's really going to help you understand how the agent is going to move before you start coding everything and you find out that things are just not working the way that you expected it to work. And trust me, that happened to me. So I learned the hard way and I ended up doing this at the end. I wish I would have started with this. So let me go ahead and set this back to default so that I don't forget. So let's go ahead and go. So that's the implementation of the aging. I know it's a lot, guys, but it's going to be available in GitHub. And I already checking some of the information in GitHub. So if you go into GitHub at DelmerV, you're gonna see that I have my Unity ML agents available to you guys. And there's two different, you know, there's two different ones already in there. This one I haven't updated the GIF, but I will by the end of this video. So you should be able to see, you know, what I have showing you in this video. So that's what the agent avoidance is. If we go into the target moving, I already kind of explained this a little bit by looking. Well, I actually didn't go into the code, but I show you what it was in the scene view. So this has a reference to the agent because we need to know, you know, how to call into the agent. This also has a target speed. So I want the agent to move. Remember, I show you how the target could move at 150 speed. It was going way too fast. This is the value that determines that. This also determines what the max distance is going to be before we can actually reset the target, reset this guy. So, and I also have the original position because I need to restore the target to its original position after it's done. The other thing that I also have here is I have the, you know, basically a check to see. And this, to be honest, I didn't really like how I implemented this. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna change how this reads. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna say, you know what, if the local position of Z is less than this max distance, then we're gonna be resetting it. And I'm gonna show you what that max distance is gonna be. It was actually really hard to read. So what I'm gonna do is perhaps about here, so we can just use -3.5. We can do -3.5, it's fine. So let's go ahead and set it back. And then what I'm gonna do here is I'm going to change this to do -3.5. It's gonna be a flow. It's gonna be a lot easier to read. So what I'm saying here is, you know what? If you reach the max distance in Unity, then I'm gonna be resetting you back to your original position. So that's what this code does. And then I just cache that information, the original position on the awake method. And then if I haven't reached the max, I'm just going to be changing the position at Z. So I just get the same position at X, the same local position at Y. And then I just decrement the position at Z by using delta time and then multiplying that by the target speed. Couple more methods that I have in here that you saw that I was calling from the agent is reset target and just, you know, allow the agent to call into this because the agent knows when something is colliding with it, right? So I can set the local position of the target based on the original position, and I can also set the local rotation just in case we have this guy, because it's using physics as well. If this guy is rotated, I'm just gonna set it back to the default local rotation. And this is what doing most of the magic. The onCollision enter gets the collision. If I'm colliding with the player, I know that I'm gonna be taking points away, and you guys can see that I have that messaging here. I also call into the agent, and I say agent that take away points. And if I'm colliding with the wall, that means, yeah, we got some points. So I'm gonna give the agent some points. So pretty straightforward. So let's go ahead and go back into Unity and make sure that everything is working how it was. I think I set this back to negative. Let's go ahead and do -3.5. And let's go ahead and go back here and make sure that everything is working still. If it's not working, then I broke something by just making that small change. And let's go ahead and hit play. And there we go. So it looks like everything is working. So if I go back to the layer, and I'm gonna show you a couple of things that we can do to make this a little bit more fun. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna do target, and then we're going to just change all the speed on all the different targets. We can do maybe like 50. As you can see, I wanted to see some red just to make sure that it was working. You can see how the aging is working. So a couple of things that I think we could do to make it fun. We can just randomize the, you know, the speed of the actual target. So one thing you can do here, instead of just doing a target speed, you can just do a max speed, right? So we can do something like max speed. And then what we can do is we can just change the max speed in the reset on target. So what I'm gonna do is we can just change this either here if you wanted to change it every time the episode starts, or what we can do is we can change it also on the awake. So it's really up to you. I think what I'm gonna do, let's actually do it both ways. Let's do max speed, and what I'm gonna do on the max speed is I'm gonna do range, and then we can do actually random and then range. And make sure you don't make the max speed too low, because otherwise it's gonna be really, really boring. So what we can do is we can do, let's actually do this. Let's do a color. We can do a minimum value, and then we can also do a maximum value, right? So the minimum, I think I'm just gonna do, I think 5 is okay for the minimum. And then we can do something like 150 for the maximum speed. And then the other thing that you can also do with this is, if you want to go, you know, fancier, you can also do a range. And the range can allow you to do what I'm basically doing in here, but you can't really capture the minimum or the maximum. But I don't want to go beyond zero. So we can do, you know, we can do the maximum is going to be 150. So we can do a range there. And then we can also do the same thing in here. We can also do maybe let's actually do 0.1F. And the maximum here is going to be 5. And then in this case, we can go say, you know what, I'm gonna go 5 to 150. I think that makes a lot more sense. And then on the minimum speed, what I'm gonna do is let's actually do minimum speed and then maximum speed. And then we can introduce another variable here, which we don't need to expose. So this one is going to be basically the speed. We can set it just to 0. And then what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna say, you know what? I'm gonna get a random number inclusive from this minimum speed to that maximum speed. It's gonna make it a lot cooler to do. And then we can also set that on the awake method. Perfect. And then what we can do is we can just say a speed instead of maximum speed here. That's just gonna give us a little more randomization. Let me go ahead and remove the using statements here. And then if we go back, and we can now start hitting play. I hope that we should be getting a lot of variety, and I don't think we will, because the maximum speed here looks like we are getting just a constant value. The reason for that is because I need to go to the agent here, and the minimum speed, I think I'm gonna set it, I think 5 is fine. And the maximum is 150, I think it's okay. And then let me do one thing here. I'm going to, okay, so it looks like we're okay. And let me make sure that the target looks fine. So we're gonna go from 5 to 150. And that's going to be set on the awake method. And then there we go. Let's go ahead and hit play and see if that looks any different. And let's give it a second. There we go. So you guys can see that some of them are going really fast, and some of them are going, you know, a lot slower. And it's actually really cool because it allows us to see, you know, what's happening. Is some of them are going really, really slow, some are going fast. I think the range is just way, way too fast. Let's do something like, I think I'm gonna do 50. And perhaps on this one, I'm actually going to allow the minimum value to be, you know, I think the maximum on this one can be something like 25. And I think I'm gonna do, let's do something higher here. And then I think that works. There we go. So I think, yeah, that looks better because I can go, you know, maybe like about something like that. maybe from 9 to 88. I think that's fine. And now if we hit play, we should see what's happening with the agents. Let's go ahead and hit play and wait. There we go. I think some of the agents are still going way too fast. Let's go ahead and go back here. And I need to do that on this, in this guy. So I'm going to do, let's go ahead and do 20 and about 50. Or perhaps 10 and 50. I think that's going to give us a variety. And then let's go back here. And sometimes I go into all of them just to make sure that I revert all the changes. Because if I have one change in one, it's just going to be applying to that. And let's hit play and see what we get now. And let's give it a second. There we go. So we're getting a lot of green and then some, you know, some red as well. And if we go into the scene view, we can see that they're actually doing really well. Some have 14, you know, this one has 18 episodes. And numbers are the reward that we are basically aggregating keeps going up. I don't attempt to say that word because I have a hard time saying it for some reason. But these, you know, show that it's working. Let's try something new. Let's go ahead and go into here. And I'm going to start doing a new brain. So let's do tests. And in this case, what we can, we gotta just do a force here because I need to overwrite the previous run. There we go. And what I'm gonna do in this case, I want the agents not to know how to move. So I'm gonna go ahead and remove the actual model. We're gonna go here and I wanna show you how this looks when we're starting. So I'm going to go ahead and hit play and show you the results. And they're gonna suck. They're gonna do really bad. And let me make sure that all agents don't have a model. Just to make sure. Yeah, there we go. And we go, and if we go into my PowerShell here, you can see that the mean reward is just really bad, right? The number is just really low. And I think the velocity, that's something that you guys gotta keep in mind, is the speed is just way, way too high for the training. And what I'm gonna do is, let me go ahead and go into my target here. And I think I'm just gonna set it to 10 and 10. And that's what I did before. And let me go ahead and go back. And I'm gonna initialize training. Make sure to include the force parameter if you wanna override it. And now we can go ahead and do a training again. And let's give it a second, there we go. So one thing to keep in mind, if you, like I said, the velocity is too high, when it goes into training, velocity is gonna be way too high that it's not gonna be able to do successful training. But in this case, it's working well, right? Like now we can see the mean reward being a positive number. You want this number to keep going up. If it starts to go down too fast or things are just not getting tracked, like we're getting, in this case, we're getting green, 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 and red. I think this is trending up, so the agents are learning. So I'm gonna leave it running for a few minutes and show you the results. All right, guys, so I think the agents are still having a hard time keeping up. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go ahead and kill it. Let me hit play. And what I'm gonna do, instead of penalizing the agents that much, we need to just not penalize them as much. It's still working, but I think if we just do, let's go ahead and do 0.01 instead of what I just did. And then I'm also going to go ahead and, let's go ahead and try that. If that doesn't work, we can just do a couple more changes. Going to go ahead and hit play, and then it's gonna go ahead and hit play here one more time. And there we go. And what I wanna do is I want to look at the metrics in this case. Let's go ahead and put this up here. Okay, so we're starting with a high number, 0.756. And let me just move it, and there we go. So that looks a lot better. You gotta be careful how much to penalize your agents, because if you penalize them too much, they're going to be giving up. And see, this is the reason why I needed to penalize them. See how they're staying on the right side most of the time? They're being sneaky, right? They're like, why would I need to move if I'm getting penalized really low? So if we go back, let's go ahead and go back. And what I'm gonna do here, let's go ahead and undo. And let's try a 3 here on the punishment. And let's go ahead and go back. And I'm going to go ahead and restart it. So you got to be really careful because the agents are realizing, you know what, I'm getting more points for staying here. And if I get penalized, you know, a very small number, it's not really matter. So you got to be really careful about that. I'm going to go ahead and hit play. And let's see what happens this time. I want to look at the numbers here. But I think overall, it's working well. You can see we're getting more green as time advances. Some red, now red is disappearing. We have a 0.6 on the mean reward and 0.8. So that's trending up, so we're doing good. And they are moving, they're just moving, you know, a little slower, but they're not staying there forever, which is what I wanted to avoid. There we go, and they are moving. We keep trending up. So I'm gonna leave these running for maybe about a 100,000 iterations so we can see the results. All right, guys, so I'm gonna call this one as a successful model. So what I'm gonna do, you can see that the numbers keep trending up. I'm gonna go ahead and stop it. And then as soon as you stop it, there's gonna be a file that gets generated on the results, in my case, tests, and then player avoidance. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go here under tests. And I already have one training data here for this one. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go ahead and remove that one and go into my results and then just drag it and drop it into training data. And then I can just delete this. I've just been doing that just to keep everything clean. And then I'm gonna go into my aging itself and then click on player and then associate my player avoidance with that. So go ahead and go back. And now let's see how this looks, right? Let me go ahead and set the camera nice and actually bigger here so we can see more of it. There we go. Now we can go into plain view and maybe let me just arrange it to look at that. Snap it back. There we go. So that's what I wanted to see. Let's go ahead and hit play. And this should be the end of this video. So hopefully you enjoy what I basically created for you. If you guys have any questions about anything that I just mentioned, please let me know. And also be sure to subscribe because that's really gonna help me in bringing you a lot more videos. And let me just go ahead and do one more thing before I end this video. What I'm gonna do is, let's go ahead and do the minimum speed. I think that looks a lot better right there. So it's everything that I wanted to show you guys. If you guys have any questions, please let me know. All right, guys, thank you for watching this video today. I really appreciate your time. And if you have any questions about anything that I just mentioned on ML Agents, please let me know in the comments. Also, be sure to check out my patreon.com site where I'm basically posting early access source code, such as the code that I'm providing in this video. And if you have additional questions, you can also let me know either via Patreon or also via email. Thank you, guys.